Αγαπητοί τηλεθεατές, καλησπέρα σας και καλώς ορίσατε στην εκπομπή Ομογένεια του Λονδίνου. Θα σας παρουσιάσουμε και σήμερα όλες τις εκδηλώσεις που πραγματοποιήθηκαν στην Ομογένεια του Λονδίνου. Πριν ξεκινήσουμε σήμερα το πρόγραμμά μας, θα θέλαμε να ενημερώσουμε τους τηλεθεατές μας από το Ηνωμένο Βασίλειο ότι μπορείτε πλέον να μας παρακολουθείτε από το Freeview στο κανάλι 244. Χρειάζεστε μια smart τηλεόραση και σύνδεση στο ίντερνετ. Επίσης, μπορείτε να προμηθευτείτε το Rockbox από τα γραφεία της ETA UK στο Southgate, όπου μπορείτε να παρακολουθείτε δεκάδες τηλεοπτικά και ραδιοφωνικά ελληνικά κανάλια από Ελλάδα και Κύπρο. Για περισσότερες πληροφορίες επικοινωνήστε με την ΣΥΤΑ UK ή επισκεφτείτε την ιστοσελίδα της www.citauk.com. Το Hellenic TV δημιούργησε το application Vision TV Net για τις smartphone και Android συσκευές σας. Έτσι, με το Vision TV Net μπορείτε να παρακολουθείτε όλα τα προγράμματά μας ζωντανά στο κινητό, στο tablet ή στον υπολογιστή σας. Για περισσότερες πληροφορίες σχετικά με τα προγράμματα του Hellenic TV μπορείτε να βρείτε στην ιστοσελίδα μας www.hellenictv.net. Επίσης, για την προβολή της εκδήλωσης ή της επιχείρησής σας, επικοινωνήστε μαζί μας στο τηλέφωνο 020 82 92 70 37 ή στην ηλεκτρονική μας διεύθυνση info@hellenictv.net. Στο απόψινό μας πρόγραμμα θα παρακολουθήσετε το Επαγγελματικό Φόρουμ με τίτλο Κύπρος, Ηνωμένο Βασίλειο, με κύριο μιλητή τον Υπουργό Ενέργειας, Βιομηχανίας και Τουρισμού της Κύπρου, Γιώργο Λακοτρύπη, ένα μικρό αφιέρωμα στο μοναστήρι του Αποστόλου Ανδρέα στην κατεχόμενη Καρπασία με αφορμή την ανακατασκευή του, την ετήσια χωροσπυρίδα του Συνδέσμου Λεπίθου, Καραβά και Περιχώρων και τέλος αποσπάσματα από το πρωτάθλημα Κόπα, φάσεις στα γκολ και σχόλια από τους συνεργάτες του σταθμού μας από τον αγώνα Μαρονίτες VS Παντέλ. Ας ξεκινήσουμε με το πρώτο μας θέμα που έχει να κάνει με το Εμπορικό Φόρουμ που διοργανώθηκε με πρωτοβουλία του Υπουργείου Ενέργειας, Εμπορίου, Βιομηχανίας και Τουρισμού και του Κυπριακού Εμπορικού και Βιομηχανικού Επιμελητηρίου και διοργανώθηκε από το Εμπορικό Τμήμα της Κυπριακής Υπάτης Αρμοστίας και υπεύθυνος για την διοργάνωση αυτή ήταν ο εμπορικός ακόλουθος της Κυπριακής Πρεσβείας κ. Κώστας Δάφος. Το Επιχειρηματικό Φόρουμ είχε τίτλο Κύπρος, Ηνωμένο Βασίλειο και διοργανώθηκε σε Λονδίνο και Εδιμβούργο στις 8 και 10 Νοεμβρίου. Κύριος ομιλητής της εκδήλωσης ήταν ο Υπουργός Ενέργειας, Βιομηχανίας και Τουρισμού κ. Γιώργος Λακοτρύπης. Ενώ χαιρετισμούς απίφθηναν μεταξύ άλλων ο Ύπατος Αρμοστής κ. Ευρυπίδης Ευρυβιάδης, ο Γενικός Γραμματέας του ΚΕΒΕ Μάριος Τσιακής, ο Πρόεδρος της Κοινοβουλευτικής Ενέργειας, Εμπορίου, Βιομηχανίας και Τουρισμού Άγγελος Βότσης και το μέλος της Επιτροπής Ηλίας Μυριάνθους. Το φόρουμ πραγματοποιήθηκε με μεγάλη επιτυχία και υποστηρίχθηκε από το Επιχειρηματικό Φόρουμ Κύπρου Ηνωμένου Βασιλείου, από το ειδησιογραφικό πρακτορείο Bloomberg, το οποίο φιλοξένησε και την ημερίδα στο Λονδίνο, καθώς και από πολλούς άλλους οργανισμούς. Στο βίντεο που ακολουθεί, πρώτα θα παρακολουθήσουμε τον χαιρετισμό και το καλωσόρισμα από τον Ύπατο Αρμοστή Ευρυπίδη Ευρυβιάδη. Αμέσως μετά τον Υπουργό παρουσίασε ο Will Kennedy, Managing Director Energy Bloomberg, από τον οποίο θα παρακολουθήσουμε ένα απόσπασμα από την παρουσίαση. Ας παρακολουθήσουμε το βίντεο και τους ομιλητές με τη σειρά που τους παρουσιάσαμε.
And still, as EU partners, both countries have a vibrant economic and trade relationship spanning for centuries. The United Kingdom is one of the biggest economic partners of our country. I strongly believe that this relationship will continue to strengthen considerably over time. I am confident that our speakers today will showcase why Cyprus is a reliable partner to the United Kingdom, especially after the island's success to emerge stronger than ever from an unprecedented crisis and much faster than anyone could have predicted 3 years ago. You will naturally have the opportunity to hear more about how Cyprus ventures forward and what exciting new investment opportunities this island offers based on the numerous business advantages it retains. And of course, I am sure that it will be covered extensively how Cyprus and the United Kingdom can work together while the British government is trying to secure the best possible Brexit deal.
It is a great honor to be amongst such a distinguished audience, and I truly appreciate the opportunity of saying a few words on behalf of the Cyprus Chamber of Commerce and Industry. It is pointless for me to talk about the importance of the business, economic, political, and social ties we have with the UK. Such a statement is not only common knowledge, but also a financial fact, with UK being one of, Cyprus's most significant trading partners, not just in goods, but its services. This is a position we aspire to maintain and further enhance in the new evolving European reality, but also in view of the decision of the British people to vote in favour of Brexit.
Tourism, of course, is vital for the island, and I think we're seeing record visitor numbers at the moment, but also energy may play a huge part in the future of the island, so I hope we hear something about that this evening. So please join me in welcoming the Minister.
Excellency, High Commissioner, dear members of the Cypriot Parliament, dear Michael and Marine, Constantine Middleton, first of all, let me start by thanking you for hosting us at this amazing, amazing venue. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I've selected to start my presentation by just one slide about the performance of the Cyprus Conference. After that, we'll be able to talk a little bit more about the benefits that Cyprus can offer. And then I'll touch upon two key topics of the Cyprus economy. One, which was mentioned earlier, the oil and gas potential, which we feel would be the future for Cyprus, but also which actually pays the salaries today, which is tourism, and we've spent a couple of very interesting days over the past couple of over this week at the World Tourism Market. Well, until they fix this, let me go through really quickly about the Cyprus economy then, and say that despite the very harsh recession that we had in 2015, having a negative growth of almost 6%, ladies and gentlemen, minus 5.9, and then minus 2.5 in 2014, we've been able to recover much sooner than anyone had predicted, and we're able to deliver a growth of 1.6% last year, and we're well on our way forecasting to grow at about 2.7% in 2016. Now, you would think I would stand here with Brexit in the horizon to tell you, rip off your UK business and come into the land of Aphrodite, like the High Commissioner said. No, this is not what we're here for. We're here to tell you that should you be looking, post-Brexit, should you be looking for an EU base, then Cyprus is the land you're looking for all the reasons that are outlined on the PowerPoint, but you will hear of during the day. EU, member state, Eurozone as well. Reliable legal framework, fundamental for UK businesses, because it's based on common law. Strategic location, all that important. Think just one more recent development, the deepening, widening of the Suez Canal. Cyprus is the first landmass you encounter as you come out, and the last one before you go into the Suez Canal. Sound taxation system, again, you'll be hearing a lot of that in just a minute. Infrastructure, human talent. My friend Peter mentioned earlier the number of students, Cypriot students studying in British universities. I don't expect that number should change, and we do have very qualified, talented people, which I must say have been fundamental in our quick recovery. Fundamentally. So what industries are attractive? Tourism, hospitality. Again, I would pay particular emphasis on that in this presentation. Energy, the same. Shipping, we have one of the largest fleets in the world. Professional services. I have to tell you about this, that the registration of new companies from between January and October 2016 grew by 22%. For the 14th consecutive month, we grew the registration of new companies. Trust is coming back. We haven't reached yet the levels of 2012, but we are getting there pretty quickly, and that's also been part of our recovery. Investment funds, technology and innovation. We haven't done, it's true, we haven't done much on technology and innovation. We are changing that, along with structural reforms, along with e-government, along with changing the way we run the country, right? We will be investing in technology and innovation. But allow me, as I mentioned at the at the beginning to touch base, because you've been hearing a lot of the presentation today, touch base on the oil and gas. You may be aware that there's been discoveries in the Eastern Mediterranean, particularly between Cyprus, Israel, and Egypt. And just to give you a number, 2,000 billion cubic meters are the discoveries of natural gas to this day between the three countries. To put it into perspective, the whole of the EU consumed 430 BCM in 2015. So even though this 2,000 BCM, most of it will be consumed regionally, mostly by the countries who made the discovery, nonetheless, there would be a point that all of the discoveries would pile up and will become an alternative source of supply and route for the European Union, for Europe as a whole. So what are we doing as a country? So far, we have five license contracts out, three contracts to Eni and COGAS consortium, one contract to Shell, Noble and Delek, and there we have one discovery named Aphrodite, I commissioned. And one block to Total. We will be having exploration activity in 2017, particularly starting with Block 11. But it is of particular importance for a reason I will talk about in a minute. But another important event is actually happening as we speak, which is the third licensing round. And the third licensing round for three blocks, Block 6, 8, and 10, has attracted the interest of very big names in the industry, despite the economic hardships which the industry is currently going through. So for Block 10, we have ExxonMobil together with Qatar, competing against consortium between Eni and Total and Statoil. In Block 6, we have a bid from Eni and Total together, a consortium. And for Block 8, we have Kern, Delek, Abner, competing with Eni.
Ο κύριος Λακκοτρίπης στην παρουσίασή του είχε και ένα βίντεο το οποίο παρουσίαζε ολόκληρο το project για το καζίνο που θα δημιουργηθεί στην Κύπρο. Ας παρακολουθήσουμε το βίντεο με την όμορφη παρουσίαση.
That's why it's falling under the Ministry of Tourism and not Ministry of Finance. We expect it will create about 4,000 jobs during construction and it will also employ about 4,000 people during its operation. Total investment we expect it will exceed 550 million euros. This is according to the proposal, ladies and gentlemen. Now, we've been working on this for 3 years. So you will allow me to take 4 minutes from your time to show you a small video.
Μετά τον Υπουργό στο Βήμα ανέβηκε ο Mike Liza, ο οποίος μίλησε για το θέμα Brexit and Cyprus, the getaway for the UK business into Europe. Ας παρακολουθήσουμε ένα απόσπασμα από την ομιλία του.
Thank you very much for the invitation here this evening. If some of you in the audience are looking at my surname and wondering whether or not I'm a member of the British Greek Cypriot community, I'm sorry I have to disappoint you, because my father came from another Mediterranean island, Sardinia, which is part of Italy, not Cyprus. But I hope, depending on how you feel at the end of my speech tonight, you might consider me an honorary member of the British Greek Cyprus community. I've been asked to talk about the opportunities for Cyprus as a potential gateway into the EU for British businesses. And I'd like to just focus on three things. First of all, a little bit of an explanation as to who we are, our links to Cyprus, and then finally to give you the position as I understand it in terms of how British business is currently feeling at the moment about the Brexit debate. So first of all, ICAW, who are we and what do we do? Well, we are a professional body for chartered accountants. We were the first national body in the world, and we were formed in 1880. In fact, we're based just down Moorgate, a few hundred meters away from here. Today, we have 147,000 members in over 155 countries. Our membership is split fairly evenly between members in practice and members in business. And it's the expertise and insights of our members in business that I'll be drawing on later on. In terms of the links between the ICAW and Cyprus, we have what I believe are deep and friendly links with many organisations and institutes in Cyprus. We've been training chartered accountants in Cyprus for over 20 years, and at the moment we have in excess of 2,000 members in Cyprus and over 750 students studying for the Chartered Accountancy exams. We work with employers, higher education and tuition providers in Cyprus to deliver very high quality financial and business training. In fact, the standard of that training is so high that Cyprus often has global prize winners from the ACA on an annual basis. Now that's no mean achievement, given that they are competing on a global stage. We are, though, acutely aware that when you work in the accountancy profession and in the financial community, reputation is everything. And we work closely in Cyprus with the Cypriot authorities, the regulators, and indeed the local accountancy body, ICPAC, to ensure that those standards never drop and are not diminished. Let me come along now to the meat of my talk tonight, which is Brexit. And let me say first of all that many UK businesses find themselves planning for a situation they didn't anticipate.
Πολλά ακόμα αποσπάσματα από αυτό το επιχειρηματικό φόρουμ στο Λονδίνο θα παρακολουθήσετε προσεχώς την εκπομπή με το φακό του Hellenic TV.